know him. I'm glad I can say tonight I know the Lord. And as the song says, best of all, he knows me. Is it possible? Is it possible to know somebody, to really know somebody, without them really knowing you? Jesus said this is what eternal life is. This is eternal life. They may know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. We become personally acquainted with God when we are saved by his marvelous grace. He knows us, and Jesus tells us that I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and I know the mine. And immediately, you know, we graduate is not a good word, but that's exactly what happens. We graduate from knowing about God to knowing God when we get saved. Praise the Lord. Genesis chapter 5. I want to read about five verses here for a lesson tonight. Try not to be too long. You ever had one of those eureka moments? You know, that like suddenly you just discovered something that you had not seen before. I had a kind of a eureka moment with these verses the other day. As many times as I have read through Genesis and read through these verses, most likely read over these verses. Something just jumped off the page with these scriptures for me the other day. And you probably all already know this, discovered it a long time ago. Genesis tells us here, this is the book of generations of Adam. In the day that God created man, in the likeness of God made he him. And my thought for just a few moments tonight is going to be in the likeness of God. In the likeness of God. In the day that God created man, in the likeness of God made he him. Male and female created he them and blessed them and called their name Adam. This is interesting. You know, the whole human race is referred to right here as being called by the name, excuse me, of Adam. In the day when they were created. And Adam lived 130 years and begat a son in his own image. In his own likeness, rather, after his image, and called his name Seth. And the days of Adam after he had begotten Seth were 800 years. And he begat sons and daughters. And all the days that Adam lived were 930 years. And he died. That's reading through the fifth verse. In the beginning, Genesis 1 and 1 says, God created the heavens and the earth. And as we read through the first chapter of Genesis, it tells us about God creating everything else. The sun, the moon, and the stars. He made the seas, he made the oceans, the mountains, the trees. Every herb-bearing seed God created. All the plant life, all the animal life. And Genesis 1 and 1 goes through and tells us about all the things that God created. Over in the New Testament, I believe in the book of John. John tells us, without Jesus Christ, there was not anything made that was made. And everything that we know exists today was made by God. Now, I don't have any trouble believing that. There are a lot of people in the world that do. God bless them. God help them to come to the knowledge of the truth. You know, and I certainly pray that they do. But God created everything. And, you know, in the beginning, God said, let there be light, and what happened? God commanded, and you know this, God commanded, let there be light, and suddenly there was light, light of some kind. You know, we have to read over several verses, several days of creation before we read about God creating the sun and the moon and the stars, but there was light before those heavenly bodies were made. And I believe the light that was shining then was none other than the glory of God shining on this world. Let there be light. God intends for there to be light, and we heard a wonderful sermon in our revival meeting about the light of God and how wonderful it is for us to behold this wonderful, glorious light of God. God said, let there be light, and immediately there was light. And God's Word gives us the indication that God just simply spoke, or that He willed this world into existence, and I confess tonight, I don't know how He did. You know, that's why He's God, and we're not. You know, He's got the answers, and we don't. By faith, we understand. By faith, we believe and trust in God's Word, and we have answers there, but God didn't tell us everything that we want to know. I don't know how God created all of these things in the world. He just simply did. But when it comes to God creating man, God didn't say, let there be man. He didn't say, He didn't command the man to come into existence like He did the light. He didn't command the man to come into existence like He did all the other things. The Word of God says, and God formed man out of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Now, I don't know what all that implies. I know that it implies something more than the light just simply being turned on. It implies something more than these things that are in the world coming into existence at God's spoken word. Somehow or another, God was engaged in the formation, the creation of man, in a way that He was not engaged in all the other creation that God's Word tells us about. I wish I could explain more about that process, but I simply can't, because I don't have the answers. I believe that we find a little bit of a clue, however, when we come to John 3:16 that says, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but shall have everlasting life. That verse is not talking about the world around us, is it? It's not talking about the planet. Jesus Christ, when He came to the world and bled and died on the cross of Calvary, He did not die to save terra firma. He did not die to save planet Earth. He died on the cross of Calvary to save this man that God created in His own image and likeness. God was engaged in the creation of this one person like no other. God was engaged, ladies, creating you and creating the woman like He was in no other. Because God's Word tells us that God took substance that was already in existence. He took a rib from man's side and He made a woman and presented her to the man. And I've told you this before. I can see Adam just saying, wow, you know, this is it. This is too much. God created the woman for the man. God created the man for Himself. And when I say man, I'm talking about all of humanity. God created man in His own image and likeness. Barbara, you may not remember, I was sitting right here, and you were sitting in the choir several years ago, when my son came in the church that day. You'd never seen him before. And you leaned over the choir rail and said, there's no wondering where that kid came from. You know, for all it's worth, you know, that kid looks kind of just like me, you know. But he kind of looks sort of like his mama too, you know. Now think about this. When God created Adam and Eve, the Bible says, God said, let us make man in our image and in our likeness. And we understand that when God said, let us, He was talking to God the Son and God the Holy Spirit. They were all there engaged in the creation of the world as we know it, and engaged in creating everything else in the world, and especially engaged in creating us. Now, if we had anything to do with having our offspring, and I know that medical science is learning more and more about, you know, the birth process and genetics and all that sort of thing, and they're tampering with things probably they don't need to be tampering with. And it's possible today to have a designer kid, you know,
to tamper with those genes and control the fact that this child might have blonde hair and blue eyes, might be tall, or whatever we think might be the perfect child. But if we had anything to do with the birth of a child, you know, we would certainly, we'd want to make that kid just like us, or just like we think he ought to be. And folks, that's exactly what God did when he created Adam. He made a man in his own image and likeness. And he made that man perfect. And he made that man for himself. Everything that was made by God. John is correct. There's not anything made that was made without him, without God, without Jesus Christ. There is nothing made that was made. And everything that was made for him and by him, that in all things he might have the preeminence. That's why you and I were created, that in our life, your life, my life, every other human being, God might have the preeminence. That's what God wants from us tonight. The preeminence. He wants our love. He wants our respect. He wants our devotion. He wants our sacrifice. He wants our service. He wants our fellowship. He wants, just like Jesus said, Father, I will that they whom thou hast given me be with me where I am. Nan and I don't have grandkids. We are deprived at this point in life. Boy, we'd love to have. You know, and when parents, you know, when they get married, they're too young to really enjoy their kids as much as they ought to. But that's what children are for. They're a gift from God. God created us in his image and likeness and made Adam perfect. And Adam enjoyed this wonderful relationship with God. A wonderful fellowship. We can only guess, folks. We can only surmise what it must have been like for Adam to have heard the voice of God. Israel heard the voice of God. Scared them to death. They said, Moses, you go talk to God for us. We're afraid if we hear his voice anymore that we'll die. Sin was the reason for that. And whenever people in this present world become conscious of being in the presence of God, it scares the daylights out of them. We were made in the image and likeness of God. Well, what does God look like? The word image implies appearance. We were made in the image of God. Just like the scripture tells us here, here's one of those eureka moments. For me, just like the scripture tells us here that Adam lived and begat a son in his own image and after his likeness. Seth, when he was born in the image of Adam. Looked like him, I'm sure, in some way. I've been convinced for a long time that we human beings look like God. And I know what you're thinking, y'all looking at me and you're thinking, preacher, are you saying God looks like us? I've been convinced of that for a pretty good long while. We are the sons of God. We are the offspring of God. If God had a refrigerator in heaven, he would have your picture and my picture plastered on it. God loves us that much. He loves us way beyond what we're capable of imagining. When God had children, God made those children in his own image and in his own likeness. Philip in the New Testament said, Lord, will you show us the Father? What was it Jesus said to Philip? Philip, have I been such a long time with you and yet thou hast not known me? He said, if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. When Jesus died and was buried in the ground, and he rose from the dead, and he ascended back to heaven, the angels of God told those disciples, why are you standing here looking into heaven? Because this same Jesus is going to come in like manner as you've seen him go away. This same Jesus, this one that rose from the dead, came out of the grave,
with that body. And he said, touch me, you know, come and feel my hands and my feet. I'm not a spirit as you think that I am. Now, we are made in the image and likeness of God. When Jesus Christ came into this world, it pleased God to give Jesus a body. What kind of body? A body just like ours. A body that looks just like Adam's. A body that was made by God, formed by God out of the dust of the ground, and fashioned in His own image. The appearance of God. I've stood and looked at the artistry of some of the world's great artists and been amazed at the talent that these people have. To stand and look at those paintings of people that look so real that it seems like they can step off the canvas. Or a statue carved out of solid granite or marble or whatever, to be so lifelike, so real, it just amazes me that anyone would have that kind of talent. As talented as they are, and as close to the real image of man that those images are, they are still not the real thing. We sit at home and we watch our televisions, and the new technologies that they're coming out almost look like they're three-dimensional, but those images that we see on the television are no closer to being like us than we are like God, even though that we are made in the same image of God. God is so much more wonderful and glorious and magnificent and holy, and everything good and wonderful that we can imagine, that, you know, it fails. We fail to grasp how much greater God is than we are. And yet, we are still made in the image of God. I like what David said. When I awake with thy likeness, I'm going to be satisfied. I like what John had to say, that we're going to be like him. When Christ comes, we're going to be like him, because we shall see him as he is. We're going to be changed into the same image, from this glory to that glory. Complete, body, soul, and spirit. Paul said, I pray God that your whole body, your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless under the coming of the Lord. One day, spirit, soul, and body, we're going to be like the Lord. And likeness speaks of kind. God is an eternal spirit. When God made us, we were made spiritual. No other thing, no other creature was made in that way. We are spiritual creatures. When God breathed into our nostrils the breath of life, we became a living soul, and that soul is going to live forever somewhere. Because of sin, much of Adam's glory was lost by the fall. Adam discovered some things, just like the devil said. God doesn't want you eating fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, because he knows you're going to be just like him. Adam discovered good and evil that day that he ate that fruit. He discovered that good was gone. As John Milton said, good was gone and evil was gone. He discovered that he was naked. He discovered that he was no longer comfortable in the presence of God in the circumstances he was in. He discovered that he was afraid of God. And he ran and hid. Man has been discovering himself ever since. He's discovered that he's dishonest. When God came and spoke to him, Adam and Eve both lied. They wanted to pass the blame off on someone else. And it's hard for man to admit his guilt before God. Adam discovered also that he was dead and separated from God and would ultimately die physically.
God's word reveals that if something doesn't happen to change, we would ultimately be dead spiritually. But God's incredible love for this child that he made was so great that no price was too great to pay. And God himself, God's only begotten Son, came here and died for us that we might be restored into that wonderful image of God. It's humbling, isn't it? To think that we are the children of God, made in God's image and likeness. We have children and we keep them close to us as close as we can, and we try to teach them everything that we can. We try to protect them and spare them from all the harms and the evils around in the world. We do the absolute best that we can, and yet, even though that we are proud of our children, every one of us in one way or another been let down by them. But our love does not end, does it? Our love does not end. And God's love for us does not end. Jesus, knowing that his time was near, he loved his own, the Bible says, and he loved them unto the end. His love for them went all the way to Calvary's cross, where he took our place and died that we might be restored into that wonderful image of God. One day the work of the Lord's going to be complete, and we are going to be body, soul, and spirit made in the image and likeness of God. That's going to be incredible. We're going to be like God in that we're never going to die. We're going to be like God in that we will never feel pain or sorrow or sadness. It's going to be perfect then. What a wonderful time that's going to be. God bless you is my prayer. We are made in the image and likeness of God. We want to ask the church, Brother Larry, if you've got a song ready, we'll ask you to stand. Our conference will begin in just a few moments. And it is our tradition, our custom, to open the doors of the church, to extend an invitation to new members. You can join the Baptist church anytime. My understanding that you can. We need to do that when the Lord is moving, when he touches our heart to do so. And at our business meeting especially, we extend that invitation. If you're here tonight, we wish to unite with this church. If you come forward and share with us your testimony of being saved, we'll gladly receive you into our fellowship. If you haven't been baptized, we'll be happy to take care of that important part of your Christian life so that you can live, as Jesus said, take up your cross and follow me. While we stand together, sing a verse to a song.
Number 97.
Oh,
morning that she expressed a desire to join the church. Many of you probably believe that she already was. She'd been coming here faithfully. And I wondered just a moment ago if she'd gotten cold feet, but she assured me that she had, even though she kicked her shoes off tonight. That's okay. She expressed a desire to unite with our church, and as she knows, and we all know, we ask everyone to come and tell us about being saved, you know, and I believe that's what John the Baptist was looking for. As those people came out to his baptism, he wanted the fruits, the evidence that they had been with the Lord, that they had been saved by his grace. So Barbara, would you tell us about being saved?
I was saved at 13 years old, and I've told everybody that it felt like that my heart was formed.
Yeah.
So I know that when I was 13 that I was saved.
All right. Heart washed. I believe the Bible talks about our sins being washed away. I hadn't heard it quite put that way. You know you're saved, ready to meet the Lord. We're going to be receiving Barbara by water baptism on her testimony of faith. What's the will of the church?
They both receive her from that.
I have a motion by Richard Crossnow, second by Harold Webb, to receive her into our fellowship after baptism. Anyone wish to speak to the motion? All in favor of the motion, every member of the church in favor of the motion, then say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Motion carried. You barely made it in. I'm just teasing. I appreciate you following the Lord. We'll have a fellowship handshake in just a few moments, okay? God bless you. Thank you for following the Lord. All right. If you'd like to be seated, we're going to take care of our business. It won't take long. Then pick out a song, Brother Larry. We will have a fellowship handshake in just a moment. I appreciate Barbara following the Lord, and that's what we all need to do. Our first order of business this evening, Brother Smith, if you're ready, is to read the minutes from our last month's meeting.
Good morning.
Brother Smith.
Huntingdon Missionary Baptist Church, that Sunday evening, June 13th, for worship service business meeting. Brother Larry Thompson, the major congregation, some good songs. Brother Stapleton made some announcements with prayer requests. Brother Jimmy Simpson led in prayer. Brother Larry sang a special. Brother Stapleton read the fourth chapter. Michael and brought a thought-provoking message entitled Good News, God News, the theme of this year's Vacation Bible School. God speaks to us every day, but are we listening? Do we hear what he has to say? God cares for us and gives us his word, the Bible, to show us the only way. After the message, Brother Stapleton called the church in business order, extended an invitation for membership. No one came. The clerk read the minutes of last month's meeting, and Brother Lee Carter made a motion to accept and read. Brother Richard Crossnow seconded the motion and it carried. The treasurer reported that there is a balance of $3,112.01 in the regular treasury, $71.93 in Change the World Fund, $577 in the Emergency Relief Fund, $371.85 in the Library Fund, and after a payment of $15,000 was made on the note, the remaining balance is $198,000. Brother Donald Parrish made a motion to accept the report. Tim Roberts seconded the motion and it carried. There was a call for correspondence. The clerk referred to a letter of thanks from Murfreesboro Missionary Baptist Church for our contribution to their ministry. There was also a letter of invitation from Calvary Missionary Baptist Church in Bolivar, Missouri, to our young people to attend their youth weekend services. These will be placed on the bulletin board for all to see. We also received a letter of thanks from Words of Hope Ministry, which included a sample DVD that can be purchased from them. And all proceeds from the sale of the DVD will go to support the Words of Hope Ministry. There was a call for unfinished business. There was none. A call for a new business, and Brother Tommy Cruz said that a company had offered to give the church a scoreboard clock for the Christian Life Center if the church would pay the installation costs. Brother Cruz made the motion to accept the offer. Brother Lee Carter seconded the motion, and it carried. Ray Smith made a motion then to adjourn the present business meeting. Brother John McClure seconded the motion and carried. The congregation was then dismissed in prayer by Brother Richard Crawford. It was then stated from moderator Ray Smith, church clerk. On June 27th, Huntingdon Missionary Baptist Church met Sunday morning, June 27th, at the beginning of a week's revival. Throughout the week, we were blessed with the presence of the Holy Spirit. Our pastor, Brother Lynn Stapleton, and our heifer, Brother Glenn Ezell, brought soul-stirring messages. The church was revived, sinners convicted. Then on Wednesday evening, June 30th, several young people came to the altar for prayer. While they were praying, Sister Jessica Wortham came forward to unite with the church. She related her experience of being saved. Brother Kenny Rush made a motion to receive her into our Christian fellowship now and full church fellowship after baptism. Brother Tim Smothers seconded this motion and it carried. During the evening, four of those who came for prayer were saved and presented themselves for membership in the church. Although those present witnessed their conversion, they were asked to give their testimony of being saved. Sister Caitlin Cox gave her testimony. Ray Smith made a motion to receive her into our Christian fellowship now and full church fellowship after baptism. Brother Lee Carter seconded the motion and carried. Sister Abby Langford gave her testimony. Brother Ray Smith made a motion to receive her into our Christian fellowship now, full church fellowship after baptism. Brother Lee Carter seconded this motion and it carries. Sister Ashlyn Tucker gave her testimony. Ray Smith made a motion to receive her into our Christian fellowship now, full church fellowship after baptism. Brother Jimmy Simpson seconded the motion and carried. Sister Hannah Hill had previously united with our church, had been baptized, but she testified that she had been mistaken and now knew that the Lord had truly saved her. Brother Jimmy Simpson made a motion to rescind the previous actions of the church, receive her now into our Christian fellowship and full church fellowship after baptism. Brother Brent Smith seconded this motion and it carried. Near the close of the service, the congregation gave the right hand of fellowship and welcome to our new members. Regrettably, there were those who did not find the Lord during the week, but we pray seeds were sown that will bear fruit in the days to come. The Lord again has blessed Huntingdon Missionary Baptist Church. Elder Lynn Stapleton, moderator, and Ray Smith, church clerk. In Huntingdon Missionary Baptist Church met Sunday morning, July 4th, for a regular worship service and a baptismal service. After some good congregational songs and prayer, Brother Stapleton administered the ordinance of baptism to Sister Jessie Wortham, Caitlin Cox, Abby Langford, Ashley Tucker, and Hannah Hill. Then after the morning worship service, the congregation gave the right hand of welcome to our new members, Elder Lynn Stapleton, moderator, Ray Smith, church clerk. This addition to the minutes is to record the death of a dedicated member of our church, Brother Gene Wilkes, June 4th, 2015.
Thank you, Brother Smith. We've heard our minutes from several meetings last month.
Second motion.
Motion by Brother Kenny Rush, second by Dr. Carter, that we approve the minutes as read. Anyone wish to speak to the motion? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Motion carried.
Our treasurer's report is next.
Brother Harold, you're ready. I noticed that Brother Smith's report went somewhat into July. This one does not. It ends the end of month. So the offering for revival and the paid preachers won't be in this report. It'll be in the next one. With the previous balance of $3,112.10, the collection for the month was $20,772.02. The expenses for the month are credit card, bank card, center, but new office chair, $148.99, and writings for office work, $324.85. Post office for our box rent, $96. Watch lumber company for vacation Bible school supplies, $26.30. Baptist Sunday School Committee for our literature, $652.15. U.S. Food Service, that was some Wednesday night meal, I think revival, vacation Bible school, other things, $453.20. E.W. James for Wednesday night meal, $130.15. Kathy Parrish for vacation Bible school supplies, $89.72. GT Capital for our copier rental, $139.03. Janice Lindsay, vacation Bible school crafts, $100.72. Walmart for different things, $158.23. Youth group, $500. Church cleaning, $1,200. Yard mowing, $400. Mitchell Whitworth for youth director, $864.50. Pastor's insurance, $529.43. Carroll Bank Trust, payment on the church, $8,000. Bill's flowers, $90. CB's barbecue for the Gene Wilkes family, $36.40. Brother Wesley Woods for preaching, $150. Pastor's travel expense, $600. Brother Eugene Brown for the radio broadcast, $100. Pastor's salary, $3,640. Utilities, $1,694.29. Total expenses for the month, $20,123.96. Balance for the end of the month, $3,760.07. Change the world fund remains the same at $71.93. Balance on the church note, $190,000. Emergency relief fund, $577. Library fund, $378.85.
Thank you, Harold. You've heard the treasurer's report.
Make a motion to accept.
Second. A motion by Tony Moore. Second by Steve Edwards to accept it as read. Anyone wish to speak to the motion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? The motion carried. We have some correspondence, I believe.
Brother
Smith.
We have two pieces that I will refer to. We have a letter from the Macon Christian Academy and up at Lafayette, Tennessee. Their Christian school, and they're telling what they offer. It's on the bulletin board out front. And naturally, they're looking for free will offerings if anybody would want to give to help support this Christian school. And I don't know that we will have anyone from down in here that would attend it, but they want to give us an opportunity anyway. So that's out on the bulletin board. Did not get a letter from Brother Brown this month. It may be in the mail, just didn't get to us, but I do have a letter from the church up at Murfreesboro. This says, "Dear brothers and sisters and Pastor Stapleton, greetings to you from the church at Murfreesboro. We are always happy to hear of your good success in the Lord's work. Perhaps you know that we have entered into our new church facility. God has surely blessed us. We are writing to express our deepest heartfelt thanks for your most generous financial support for more than 2 years. May God richly bless you for those thousands of dollars you sent on our way. At present, our attendance and offerings have increased to the point that we can now make it without any help. So we request that you consider helping someone else. God only knows how much your checks, letters, and prayers have meant to all of us. God be with you all your endeavors. In Christ, Kevin Matthew.
Thank you, Brother Smith. Some of you have been to Murfreesboro, see their new church building. It is beautiful. And we're thankful that God is blessing them. They're growing and they're in a good position, I think, to grow some more. Beautiful location, a beautiful building, a tremendous opportunity. So let's keep them in our prayers. That brings us to old business. And I might just make a note of this so we don't have any old business to take care of. But we have been looking toward purchasing this house right next door to us, Ms. Pat Fuller's home. Ms. Pat has remarried. She has moved, and the house is in foreclosure. Unfortunately, there will be an auction at some point, and hopefully we'll be ready at that point to take charge of that matter. But anyway, let's remember Ms. Pat Fuller in prayer. Do we have any other unfinished business? We'll move on to new business. The only item under new business that I'm aware of this evening is the election of an election committee. Our elections will be coming up in another month, and we need a committee to talk to all of our Sunday school teachers and officers, church officers, for the upcoming year. We need to make that selection in the form of a motion. I think we, in our discussion, overlooked taking care of that detail. I believe Brother Donald Parrish and Brother Tom Moody are on that committee. Brother Steve Edwards, have you consented to serve on that committee? We need a motion to that effect, if that's agreeable to everyone.
Brother Bonner, I make a motion that we select Brother Steve Edwards.
Okay.
Second.
Motion by Dr. Carter, second by Tony Moore, to elect Brother Steve Edwards to this committee. We have a committee where we rotate one member off each year, and Brother Dr. Carter gladly rotated off this year. So we appreciate Brother Steve being willing to serve. You've heard the motion. Anyone who wishes to speak to the motion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Motion carried. Any other business tonight?
Question. He's saying that Brother Manson says to find someone else. Do we know another church?
We are discussing that right now, Brother Tony, discussing possible mission efforts as well. We're in the process of looking for good work to support. Any other? Y'all ready to call it quits?
Second.
Got a motion to adjourn by Brother Smith, second by Richard Crossno. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right, Brother Larry, you got a song ready?